Welcome to the New York Botanical Gardens Portfolio Lecture Series. I'm Susan Cohen, coordinator of the Landscape Design Program at the Garden and founder and coordinator of this series. Before introducing tonight's speaker, I would like to thank Monica Heimbold, who is here tonight. The Heimbold Family Foundation has supported this program generously for several years. So thank you, Monica. Each fall for 18 years, the Portfolio Series has presented outstanding landscape architects from around the country and the world. Tonight's speaker, Charles Jencks, comes to us from Great Britain. American by birth, educated at both Harvard College and the Harvard GSD, Charles received his PhD in architectural history from University College London in the 1960s and has lived in Great Britain ever since. He is well known as a prolific author, architectural critic and historian, a cultural theorist, a landform artist, and a landscape architect. Perhaps his most well-known design landscape, and I know many of you here know about it and some have seen it, is the Garden of Cosmic Speculation, created over several decades and on over 30 acres at his country home in Scotland. A few years ago, Charles spoke here in New York about the Maggie Cancer Caring Centers, a network of free cancer patient support centers that he co-founded with his late wife, Maggie Keswick. There are now, I believe, 19 of these centers designed by influential architects, including Frank Gehry, Norman Foster, and Rem Koolhaas. Charles's book about these centers is called appropriately, The Architecture of Hope. Tonight, though, he will speak about his own landscape work, and his topic is the universe as artist. After his talk, Charles will take a few questions, and then he will sign a copies of his book, The Universe in the Landscape, in the lobby area just outside those doors. Thank you for coming, Charles, and welcome.
Thank you, Susan, for having me, and the Botanic Gardens for having me. I'm very pleased to be here and seeing the Botanic Gardens tomorrow. I'm going to be speaking on the universe as artist, a metaphor, the universe as an artist, and the art of the universe. And I will be speaking, as Susan has just said, on some of my work and my writing and ideas behind what I'm doing. And I should say at the beginning that some of these ideas are very old. For instance, the idea that the universe is a kind of artist goes back to Plato, goes back to prehistory. And art is, of course, different from science and religion as a discourse, and artists can do things, have artistic license to do things that scientists can't do, and they cut across the universe, as it were, as a subject, in a different way, because they make analogies between the very big and the small, or the small and the very big, or the middle, all the time, making metaphors and comparisons, and they do it for another reason than scientists and theologians, or those who are very religious. They do it to attract you, to repel you, to move you, to engage your feelings. So the universe as an artist, of course, brings up those other aspects, those feelings, analogies, and so forth. I should also say, by way of introduction, that we're living to the greatest age of cosmology. In many ways, the first great age, which starts in the 1910s and 20s with Einstein and Hubble and others. It is a golden age of cosmology, and it changes our relationship to the universe in extraordinary ways, in ways that religion and science hasn't done in the past. So those ideas will be coming out as I speak. And I show you the very first slide, which has been taken about a year ago of something that everybody thinks was taken in 1995, which indeed it was taken then by our famous Hubble spacecraft. But this is an updated view. And you know, when you think about the universe, usually the universe isn't as vivid as this, as artistic. Of course, this has been color corrected a bit by color filters. But it's really engaging, and it's changing. From 1995, it doesn't look the way it looked in 1995. And usually things in the universe change much more slowly, but it has changed. And it's called the Eagle Nebula. Or, it's got three different names. The Eagle Nebula is, it's hard to see it as an eagle, but if you strain hard and look at it in a certain way, you can see the head and the wings. Metaphor. It's also called the Pillars of Creation. The Pillars of Creation is very close to us, and that's why we have such incredible focus. And what it shows in creation is a whole lot of stars emerging, pushing up through the gas and the dust and all that nebulous stuff that creates stars, and blowing out with as a star is created, it creates great energy and it pushes everything away from itself. So you're seeing the billowing, the pillars. It's very dynamic. And Hubble brings it forward as an art form. Maybe it's the most popular of the Hubble pictures. But the universe is not only beautiful and moving and creative, but it's violent and ugly, catastrophic and upsetting. And one of the arguments is that the universe and we are very close to each other, intimately. And the sun, particularly, is our very close ally. The sun has been represented throughout Western history as the great god Apollo of reason and the great killer god Apollo, or Constantine and the Romans, Sol Invictus, the sun as victorious. Constantine always used to fight with his back to the sun to blind his enemies. Christ was represented as the sun for 500 years or more, 1,000 years. And Louis Quatorze was a great sun god. It's all been man as sun as man. And you can see the sun here sending out an incredible flare, which perhaps in New York you experienced, I think 1988 when it let loose, this incredible burst of magnetic energy, and you see it, the magnetism up in the back there, billowing there, but you see this flare coming out, zapping, and it turned off the everything in Montreal and Toronto. In Canada, northern seaboard was out for 4 days because of this flare. The flare is a killer flare, probably killed life on Mars when Mars tipped over. So as a man, the sun is not really a man, I don't think, and I'll be going into the gendered female relation to the sun because it gives us warmth, very important, of course. It gives us photons, photosynthesis. It gives us gravity, holds us in its embrace. It's a woman. So metaphors from religion and science, I think, are what artists can criticize and adopt and displace. And some of the great cosmic art, Giovanni di Paolo, in the 15th century and later, painted these wonderful combined hybrid paintings of God, the great architect of all things, you see, and creator. He's actually not looking at his creation, which is earth, air, water, and fire. The earth in the center, the red is the fire, the air is between. So it's a Greek cosmology and geometry, indeed perfect spheres, beauty, order. But he's also looking at this act on the right. And I was looking at close, because I've never seen it close. I tried to see it yesterday, but it was closed at the Met. You see that the avenging angel is expelling people from a garden, of course. The garden, the great place, the Botanic Gardens, has come from this great garden. And they look kind of like Woody Allen as they're leaving the garden. They say, what did I do? What are we doing here? But I must see the painting. Anyway, God is looking at them while he's, the master of geometry and beauty. So in Jewish traditions and Christian traditions, it's a double kind of art, which is both narrative and geometric. And now, nature as an artist is an old idea, but nature is only 4 billion years old, and the cosmos is 13.82 billion years old. So for the first 9 billion years, there was the universe, and then there was nature, growing nature. This has been an inspiration to us, and for me, it's a place near where we live in Scotland, and it shows that wonderful Chinese metaphor of the bones of the earth and the, if I can point, get my pointer going here, yeah, the bones and the veins or the arteries is water down here, and in a, you know, when the sun hits it in the late summer afternoon, you really feel the relationship, this kind of haptic animal relationship to the landscape. So those metaphors of Chinese gardens and metaphors of the West are all in the garden art. And so if you think of nature as an artist and what they said in the 19th century, when they used that metaphor a lot, they went to the Grand Canyon, which you remember was first seen as horrific and an ugly place and worthless place, you know, until for the first time the American government investigated and said, it's not, just leave it, just awful place, destitute. And then later, of course, they fell in love with it. And photographers went in there and said, me, I'm part of the, you know, the landscape, and I am nature taking a picture of itself. That was their metaphor. Me as a piece of nature. So photographers photographing the Grand Canyon. But also, you can see with the bowerbirds, the same metaphor here is, I mean, and again, a Garden of Eden for bowerbirds here, with wattle and daub and three kinds of fruit and bottle caps on one side and blue flowers in the other. And of course, the male bird is showing off not only what he's built here, this garden, but the garden's function, of course, is to get the bird, in a bad metaphor, but get her inside. And it works. And bowerbirds are creative with all sorts of things. So nature is a creator and an architect, a landscape architect, as well as the universe being an architect and a landscape architect. So, as I say, it goes back to prehistory, and you get a feeling for that in any great stone circle. This is one in the Lake District in Castlerigg near Keswick. And it performs what's around it, and it performs the cleft in the mountains and the hills, and it really articulates everything within viewable distance. So it's an old idea, and it has many roots. And I come back to Plato here, God, the great architect of all things, with his compass and his architectural instrument, his omniscience, stepping out of the frame. You see his omniscience. And he is looking at his work and looking down at the, again, the earth, air, water, and fire. As he lays out the sun, the moon, and he's actually laid out water as a fractal, interesting, in the 13th century, before fractal geometry. Anyway, that view is, of course, very much our view of a creative universe, a creative God, creative man. At the same time, it's contested by another very current 1992 image, and then 2003 WMAP, and then 2013, all of which is confirmed closer and closer, zoom in on what the universe looked like 380,000 years after the beginning in the microwave background. Before I knew really what it meant, I first of all put an eye in it, the eye of the universe, and then secondly, started to divide it up like Danny Liebskin would, with a whole series of crosses and zeros, noughts and crosses. And it turns out that I stumbled on the truth. This is the Milky Way, by the way, because you can't see the universe without looking through the Milky Way, so it's all blood red. Anyway, you see that one, that's where in 2013 they think we may have bumped another universe. So these theories, these sciences, and these views come down to us. And my work, which is based on speculation, speculates with artists and craftsmen and others, philosophers and friends, and my wife, Louisa, who's here, and others, about what are the basic units of the universe? What ties us to the universe? What are its fundamental, unchanging, eternal forms? And I'll come to the reason for that in a minute, but I want to underline the fact that you don't have to really know much to appreciate this. And a photographer who went to the landform I designed called Northumberlandia, or the Lady of the North, a photographer spent all night, and I didn't ask him to do this, he spent all night, a very cold night, he spent with his dog photographing the universe and the Lady of the North. You see her outline here. But he caught, the rotation, just as the Egyptians did, around the unmoved mover, the North Polar Star, reflected in the water too. If you could see that, you would see how beautiful that was. So he and his dog experienced the cosmic relationship to this landform. And aside from being a woman, in some respects, it's really so big, it's 2/5 of a mile, 2 miles of walk, is that you don't see it as a woman very often. It just comes into view and goes out of view, and you see it more as a series of rhythms or land waves in the landscape undulating, and which are similar to each other, these forms, zigzag forms up her knee or up the back of her head. And my job as a landscape architect was to get people to walk the walk. So being 2 miles of walks, and you come in here through a forest, and you look through the first stage and so on, is to walk all the way to her feet and walk, run, actually. People, a lot of runners use it as an exercise place. And to enjoy not only what she is as a landform, but to enjoy everything around her, like the North Sea is off here. And so I've picked out 10 parts of her body as special shelter points, and created a drama in order to ask or encourage people to walk through and over her and around her. So you see double faces here, you see two eyes and nose and a mouth, and you see the number one, and you're looking at her head. You see people climbing all over her. And as you walk through the 10 stages, you finally get to the 10th point, which is on her head. You remember Raquel Welch, the great American philosopher, who said the sexiest organ of the human body is the head, the brain. Great, great insight, by the way, I think. One of my arguments is that meaning is an aphrodisiac in an age of aestheticism. Anyway, this hand, I want to change the frame a bit, because in the age, we're living through a long age of the crisis of meaning, a crisis for the client, for society, and the architect, and the designer, and the landscape architect. So you see here the culmination is the eye of the universe, and instead of pointing out at the rest of the landscape, it points up at the sun, which is, it says, 93 million miles away, and there's the sun, and it's a hand made out of fiber and so on, and concrete. Well, a young man of 22, I presume it was a man, broke it after the first, took a sledgehammer and broke it, but left the hand broken there. And I repaired it, and he broke it again, and I repaired it again. And he broke it a third time, and I repaired it again. And he broke it a fourth time, and I repaired it again. He broke it a fifth time, and I repaired it finally in steel. And it hasn't been broken, but I'm sure it's been smashed. So, and why do I bring this up? Because in landscape, landscapes and icons, I was asked to design an icon of the North here. Icons in our democratic culture create iconoclasm, and necessarily so. So I don't mind too much the struggle But it is a struggle, and you have to fight it, not only with this young man, I presume he was a man, but with society, with the client, and with all of us. In other words, if you directly, if your work is meaningful, and if we are meaning-seeking animals, not just rational animals, as Aristotle said, but we seek meaning, then it's important in a crisis of meaning to try to, well, you have to fight to bring it back. And I'll be coming back to that idea. Now, the second main point is that we're living in the age of the billion-dollar building. And we have been for 15 or 20 years since famous Richard Meyer's Getty Museum was finished, the building on the hill in Los Angeles. And in a way, it shows the crisis of meaning, because $1 billion of work given to a single architect who was told not to make a white building by the Getty, spent a lot of time designing five or so museums in an age of the museum as cathedral, where the museum has taken over the primary meaning for a lot of society. And his symbolism, so far as it existed, was partly, well, of course, it's a white, you could say it's a white Italian hill town. In a way, it's a crown on a hill. But he talked about how it picks up the geometry of the 405 going south on Los Angeles, you know. And so it's shifted axes. So it's abstract, I mean, on a symbolic level. And of course, it's endlessly white. He said, it's not white. No, no, it's off-white. Anyway, you know, there is a crisis when buildings, when the new normal is the $1 billion. And in Las Vegas, this set of buildings designed by great architects and friends of mine, as Richard Meyer is, by Cesar Pelli designed one of the buildings, and Norman Foster designed a second, and Danny Liebskin designed the Crystal Shopping Center as a third. Wasn't just $1 billion, it was $10 billion for this development. It went bankrupt not once, but twice, you know, bailed out by Abu Dhabi. Anyway, you can see that Gucci has taken over the Crystal, and again, is a crisis of meaning in our culture. Not only size, bigness, and commerce, but the way meanings tend to be dissipated in an agnostic or neutral time. And so the winner of the competition of the American Embassy in London, where we live, the new American Embassy is a white building. It's, in a way, it's a nice ecological expressive of, you know, of the sun. But it's basically a defensive building surrounded by a moat and all of these other elements that people can't get near it. And it's just a white cube in the end. And, you know, it's another billion-dollar building. So in the age of the billion-dollar iconic building, we have problems. Now, I'm happy to say there is a billion-dollar botanic garden, which is a rather amazing garden in Singapore, paid for by the local casino, by the way. That's how they funded this. And I've been through it with Dr. Tan and others, and it's an incredible building. And, you know, its vision for Singapore is like the vision for Central Park in this town, I mean, of Olmsted. It's unbelievable what they're doing. And if you go there in 20 or 30 years, you'll see it is their Central Park. It'll be surrounded by skyscrapers all the way around, and it's just unbelievable. And it had a symbolic program, I'm happy to say, based on an orchid and a whole lot of metaphors that come from Singapore as a garden city. So here, the billion-dollar, you know, landscape looks better than the billion-dollar building. The iconic building, of course, the age of the iconic building, one of the icons was this skyscraper of Norman Foster, which is very positive in many respects, designed to work off vegetable oil, so it's the most ecological of skyscrapers. As you know, it was called the Gherkin, not as in the land of Oscar Wilde, never to call a spade, they call it a gherkin. Doesn't look like a pickle. I mean, it doesn't look like the metaphor I've put there at all. But you say gherkin, not to say what they think it looks like. And I had Matt Law of Riesendorp do some sketches of metaphors I've seen in the building. And you know, the rocket, the screw, and the bomb are paranoid signs after 9/11. This came on stream 2003 and 4. Amazing that they built this in the after that time. And on my first try of the iconic building book, I did this fruit version of Norman Foster's metaphor, and the publisher said, that's not going to work. It would sell under military hardware. So the paranoia had, you know, I changed the design. But you can see other metaphors, the brain and the unmentionable and the finger and the Fibonacci series, pine cone, pineapple, and the scar. So a multiple mixed metaphor is one of the ways good icons are better than one-liners and communicate with, instead of the paranoid sign, just there is the power of the enigma. So in our age, the enigmatic signifier has taken over the role of the monument, at least in the West, to produce a whole series of icons which suggest and never name, but suggest sometimes in a positive way what their function is and what their deeper meaning is. So I found in this book, in analyzing 2005, that there are in the codes, the multiple codes and metaphors often relate to nature. And you see Rochon, Le Corbusier, you see Bilbao, you see Rem's buildings, and the Herzog de Meuron bird's nest building in Beijing. And so nature has become the referent in certain iconic buildings, and that's positive. So our little iconic buildings for Maggie's centers have a different take on this. I mean, they are buildings for cancer care, and our social purpose or social program is indeed connected with very basic life and death issues. And it gives these icons a certain purposeful meaning in their symbolism. Frank Gehry's building here is in Dundee, looking out over the River Tay. He picked an amazing cosmic site next to a mass hospital, you know, for 12,000 people. He picked this particular site and built his nice little small building with this lighthouse view over the Tay River to the cosmic mountains in the background. So these buildings, Richard Rogers' Maggie Center in London is another icon, both in its orange, imperial red-orange color and its pavilion, and a more recent center by Snow Hetta is, of course, another icon, and a cosmic one at that, which performs different views of the sky through its voids, through its front door, and adopts metaphors like the pebble and the egg to welcome people in. So these enigmatic signifiers are now, I think, very conventional among architects. And this raises the question, which I've tried to address in my work, of iconology, because in the age of the icon, to not confront in a public way what your building is supposed to communicate seems to me irresponsible in some ways. And I don't think architects have allowed themselves to do that, to straightforwardly defend their icons with an iconography and an iconology. In other words, they don't say to the client, okay, you want an egg, I'm giving you an egg, or you want, you know, something that relates to birds. Well, actually, Herzog and de Meuron said, we're going to do a bird's nest. They did that with Ai Weiwei. So occasionally, architects will admit the metaphors, the multiple metaphors of their building. And my work tries to engage it directly. So for CERN, where I worked a bit with my daughter Lily, we worked together, Jencks squared. It's based on collisions, and they send protons and antiprotons at each other at the speed of light, almost the speed of light, to create, with the smallest things, the protons, the biggest conclusions. Their big idea is, how does the huge relate to the small? How does the microcosm and the macrocosm relate? That's the big search. And so in developing an iconology, I've used this rather obvious pun, iconology, because the I is like a linear accelerator. In other words, it's like looking through a telescope or a microscope or through a computer. It's we're seeing things which are too fast and too big and too small to see without those linear accelerators. And so for CERN, we designed this these mounds and surrounding their dome, and they told the history of the universe, and they end in two question mark mounds under which buildings are. How does the very little quantum physics relate to the very big relativity? And the answer is, we really don't know. And every time we try to relate them, we produce infinities. And when a scientist sees an infinity, he goes crazy, or she goes crazy. He says, error. It's like a computer saying E, you know? So we don't know. Anyway, so that's the big mystery. Anyway, I work with scientists sometimes. Jim Watson I've worked with many times on DNA models and later in RNA models, which I won't show you. But you see Jim Watson here on the right, and a scientist I work against on the left, Richard Dawkins. and Richard Dawkins, of course, the originator of the idea of a selfish gene, sold 3 million copies in Britain alone. He was the scientist in charge of the public understanding of science to the British nation, funded to $1 million by Bill Gates. Imagine selfish genes. I mean, the metaphor is as stupid as saying altruistic genes, of course, and to emphasize selfishness was a choice, a very good one from selling books. Anyway, as far as I'm concerned, my work is an attack on the selfish gene, and if it isn't the selfish gene, when what is it? Well, it's complex, but it's created, as you see, this flying garden of DNA and the senses here flying through the universe. This is what the teaching model of DNA is, you know, ATCG and all of that, and the hydrogen bond, and the amazing thing, that's how you teach it. But as a metaphor, the teaching mechanism is dead. So the question for an artist is, how do you make it interesting? How do you make it alive? How do you make it haptic? And so in this garden of DNA and other things, you see various DNA in the center of each cell, the six cells, and they communicate across, and that's what, for one reason, why genes are not selfish and can't be, or else they're edited out by these little, you know, communication links between one cell and another. So my work works with scientists, but works against them. And how do I do that? Well, you know, criticize, you have to understand the concepts and as much of the physics and so forth as you can, and then take another position. So the big DNA here focuses on a woman looking down. You see the different kinds of planting we've used. And some of the planting is semantic and symbolic. For instance, where the woman whose mind and eyes are looking at her brain, you see these little fingers sending neural impulses into her brain, and she's on a car spring, and she's bouncing like that the whole time, and she's surrounded by the plant called Love in a Mist, and Love in a Mist also bounces like that. And so the planting and the fingers bouncing and the brain, the mind, and the two are in, you know, constant movement. I once, when I was working on this sort of idea, and of course, it's here it's the sixth sense, number six. The other five are in the garden, in this DNA garden. But the sixth sense is the female sense, this sense of anticipation, intuition. And Maggie once told me when I asked her, what is female anticipation? She said, she put her fingers up and she went like this. She said, you know, it's when you understand things without knowing why. It's the intuition. And it's a kind of global feeling that this must be right. And interesting, so I designed this. My old teacher at Harvard told me, well, Einstein's greatest phrase about this was that a good scientist has to have Fingerspitzengefühle. It means, you know, things at the edge of your fingertips. What's going to happen next? That's what a good scientist has. So by accident, I derived as it bounces away. As the garden, as sensorium then. Why, when you come in a garden, it appeals to the five senses and more. And that's what I was trying to communicate. So you see a sense of hearing under an ear and a parabola that moves in the wind, which makes noise as it jingles bells above anopheles, all of that kind of silver of flowers. And then to the left, the sense of touch. You can't see the hand, but that's sprung so that the slightest breeze makes it move. So a hand waves at you there, and the hand is surrounded by Scottish thistles, which prickle your hands, and nettles. Yes, nettles in a garden. How many people plant nettles in their garden? It's considered the worst thing you can do. Well, a nettle makes your hand come alive, you know, with prickles, and you have to then cleanse it with lamb's ear and dockweed and other things which are planted there too. And so the sense of taste is clearly iconic. It's Marilyn Monroe's lips above wonderful wild strawberries, which you reach down and pick. And the wild strawberry is, of course, extremely tasty. So each of the senses in a garden of the sensorium, you know, accentuates that our relationship to nature. Susan asked me to show one park, and I show you Parco Portello in Milan, which I've been working on since 2002. You know, the slow movement originated in Italy, slow food, and to do anything in Italy is practically impossible. Anyway, we're still working on it, and these mounds were built on the remains of the car manufacturer, not the Aston Martin, I'm trying to remember. Alfa Romeo plant of 1907, that's right, the Alfa. So the man who commissioned it, Brunelli, he said, he could speak almost no English and I could speak almost no Italian. And he said, oh, Charles, I love the velocity. So that meaning got through. But my program was based on prehistory, history, and the present, and a whole series of other symbolic and geometric ideas. And he said, well, you know, Charles, I don't like one thing about your garden. And I said, what's that, Marco? He said, I don't like ornament. And I said, I don't like ornament much either, but I don't have any ornament. It's all symbolism, Marco. Anyway, I thought it was interesting, a conflict which you have in the age of, you know, the icon, when meaning is thought not to be important. But there's part of the garden is the time walk, an intimate garden of walking back and forth with flowers and scent, and the four seasons, spring, summer, autumn, winter, and four different, and more than four, but those four major plants. So the planting program works there, and then you know, the different ages of people, and then the age of the universe, the 13.82 billion years, you walk there with all of the ages picked out, and then day, night, day, night, day, night, day, night, and then the heartbeat here. So this garden is called the Ritmo del Tempo, the rhythm of time, because time has these amazing rhythms. Of course, the months, 28-day cycle of the human, Everything is a rhythm in nature. And this garden in different stages, there's December, the month of December, there's night, day, and the heartbeat, even, you know, ba-dum, 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 it's another rhythm, there's different season. But conflict again, and conflict of meaning. At the top of prehistory, I created this galaxy, which I won't go into the complexity of it, and a sundial at the center, which has been removed, and these black and white day and nights coming up. And then for the morning sun in June, bouncing on the tops of these stones, beautiful pieces of minerals, as the sun rises, and then on the other side, the sunset. And so as public symbolism, of course, I had to explain to the public who comes through, and there's all sorts of signs and writings which explain this, what these things were. And as the sun rises, ritmo sorge means uprising or dawn in Italian, and it's made out of a series of kitchen knives cut off at the base, and the euro dollar, or whatever it is, the euro, 1 euro piece, showing the sun bouncing like energy on top of knives. Anyway, I was really pleased with this symbolism and its ad hoc, very inexpensive, because he didn't want to pay for any symbolism, so he hated ornament and anything that wasn't velocity. Anyway, what happened was, and this happens always, in Milan and Madrid and every major city, is the graffiti artists came in and sprayed every inch of everything, as they do for 10 miles, you know, all over Milan. It's just nothing but spray cans. It's like New York, and you know, when they did that with the undergrounds, sorry, the subways. And I rather like this because, you know, there's their meaning, like ancient Pompeii, you know, in Rome, and here's my meaning. And so they didn't smash me, but they just sprayed everywhere around. And I mean, meaning is a negotiation, and this graffiti adds a certain thing. But it's interesting, the client then took out all of my symbolism. He removed it because he was art. You know, he didn't want it to be damaged. So they've taken away all my meaning. Okay. There are happy stories when you really fight and you win, and it's amazing when society takes this first scheme in south of South Korea, and a city called Suncheon City, which is trying to reinvent itself, and through ecology, industrial nightmare of what had happened, pollution and mass heavy concrete industries. And so they came and asked us to, Lily and me, they asked me, and I got my daughter Lily. And we were at the center of 84 national gardens here around. And you can see the mountain landscapes. It's typical, 70% of Korea is like this, mountains. And then the valleys are inhabited and industrialized, and the river going through, and the sea, the open sea. And why this is a special place, and why they got the International Festival of Gardens for that year, 2013, was that they have an incredible wetlands in which a lot of foreign birds, especially the hooded crane, flies in all the time and lands. And they have terrific crabs, and they have all the animal kingdom right there. But aside from that, the city is moving forward here, and you can see how nature has been industrialized, factory farming there. Anyway, so we decided to borrow the landscape, as the Chinese say, as Asian cultures do. And we had our seven mounds here reflecting everything you can see in the distance. So literally building small versions of their mountains, because the mountains, you know, if you think about it, gave them their wetlands and gave them their river. And so we turned the city inside out. The city became the water, their river became our bridge, and their mountain in the center of their city, imagine Central Park is a mountain now, their mountain we created as a center mound, so you could see this, our mound here, and you look out and you see their mound there, and then you look across each one of our mounds, you see one of their mountains. And so we put forward the symbolism of holding the eco line for their eco-geo festival. And they understood what we were doing, and we understood their narrative. And amazingly, well, we were surprised because we were invited to the opening, and they never told us, but they had an Olympic-style opening with 5,000 performers and about 20,000 viewers, and it was went out watching it from here, and they performed in these lakes. They performed both their mythic history, their history, and their reinvention of ecology. So, for instance, just one picture of the hooded crane dance by 100 hooded craned women dancing on the water. Of course, they provided a dance floor just 2 inches below the water. But they really interpreted what we had done and used it as a vehicle for expressing their hopes for the future. And indeed, it worked. 5 million people came the first year, 4 million the second and third years, and they have got the designation as the top national garden of Korea. So the fortunes of the city were intentionally turned upside down, and it worked. So every now and then, symbolism makes that link. I want to end looking at one scheme in a little bit more detail. The scheme I'm still working on in Scotland, in the west coast of Scotland, in a very poor area of coal mining. And of course, as you know, the coal mining industry of Scotland has really gone up the tubes, intentionally so. They've more or less destroyed it. The government has. And this area, based on coal mining, is very, very poor. And so I was asked by Richard Buccleuch to renovate an old coal mine, which was disused, which was 55 acres. And this is the site I saw when he took me out there and showed me this wasteland of pollution and depravity and nothingness. You know, I looked at the ground, and the ground was desert. I mean, amazing, desert in the wettest part of Britain. How can you have a desert, you know? What to do? And furthermore, he had no money, I mean, to do anything. And it was the towns asking us to do it. So, you know, it seemed hopeless in the first week or so. And then I discovered that, strangely, the area around it had been a cosmic prehistoric area, and a local laborer had dug up one day in 1870 this lunula, moon, an amazing gold moon, 4,300 years old, with so beautifully tooled. You can see some of the ornament just on the edge, I think, make it out there. The Akantagert lunula, it's called. Akantagert means field of the priest, and it's really, with its twists in gold, it's better than Mycenaean gold in a way. And of course, it's the moon. So I began to think about that as the content, and because we had no money, I did just the very basic things. I just put in a north-south line, you can see here, just bisected the thing. We did have diggers to depollute the site, so I asked them to scallop, you know, where the coal miners had left this dump up the side of the hill. They created the site, two galaxies and one or two other cosmic things. And then nothing happened for 5 or 6 years, and then suddenly we started to build. And the only thing we had to build, we had no material, no money, but we did find a few boulders, and I started sorting the boulders, and we had mudstone, red sandstone, and yellow-white sandstone. So I started to collect them as we dug away, and thought, well, of course, the body, the hand, is something we relate to, and did this model of, well, there you see it in reality, pointing at the North Star, at the top of the North Point. And it is, you know, it's a kind of cosmic observatory when it's not raining, and you can see the sky doing that, 53 degrees, you know, that. So we made this hand this pointy hand. And happily was one day there following my daughter's dog here on the north-south line. And I saw, oh, look, a rainbow has landed like the yellow brick road right on my symbolism. That's nature confirming the symbolism. Anyway, that's what it is, the north sign. And it tells, well, it says, come to me. It's a white plastic sign explaining what is the surrounding cosmic, and it is a cosmic view. I mean, that's the amazing thing. When I saw the potential, you know, after a while I realized, gosh, to have a desert in the wettest part of Scotland is great. Keep the desert so where you can. So you, part of the desert in the foreground, you see it there. It's kind of anti-gardening in a way. But it roars back, nature roars back. Anyway, in the foreground of the map is the multiverse, the Andromeda and Milky Way. And so that people who make this long walk come up there to this attracted by the sign can get the payoff view, which is this bowl going 20 miles around it. So it is rather like Brogdor Stone Circle. It is rather like the great prehistoric things that perform the adjacent and far distance. One day I was working on the site and a coal train, still in use, went by. You see, bum, 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 right? So we have coal going right by us. And this whole valley is the valley of coal, maybe the first coal dug in Europe. On the hills, actually, it was just on the land, so people could pick up coal. Anyway, it's I love the kind of primitive rhythm of the train and the primitive rhythm of the only thing I could build with, these mudstones here, you see, placed in. And it's sort of a very moving analogy between what I was doing and the fact that coal is, on a certain level, petrified sunlight. So sun, the south, the obvious way in which coal and sun and energy are all connected was the obvious meaning. And I had, as I say, very little means to represent it. So the work is rather like Arte Povera, or, you know, the art of Italy in the 50s when there was no money in Italy. But one day I saw this amazing illusion, which I painted in this overall panoramic view of this cosmic site. I saw what's called a 22.5-degree halo. If you put your hand out, you may see it one day, and then just put your hand out, because what it is when the ice, very much in the upper atmosphere, suddenly forms a 360-degree globe around the sun. Don't look at the sun. You've got to put your other hand in front of the sun. But it forms an amazing kind of moon bow, or actually it's an ice bow. And I thought I would paint that and paint the sun, you know, in the sun amphitheater. So that was the idea of the sun amphitheater, cosmic collisions and other cosmic things going on there. And then, of course, I managed to persuade Richard Buclue to spend a little bit of money on the symbolism. And I started to research the relation of the sun to the earth and found out that, you know, there is the solar wind, there's the heat, as I mentioned, which is beneficent, there's the photons, the light, which gives us photosynthesis and all the energy that coal comes from. And so it is a very warming and embracing object. And yet, it does send out those killer flares. And what happens then? You can just make out, here's the Earth. And the Earth has its magnetic shield, which is around it because we rotate like that. And the magnetic shield takes that flare and it pushes it down in that direction, so the solar flare doesn't cook us. Every time it happens, and it happens quite often, an 11-year cycle, solar flare comes out, bang. Happened in 1830 when it actually, it was a big event then in New York when people were doing telegraph and they dot, 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 all stopped. That was a flare that was the biggest flare I think we've ever had. But so it's really incredible that this magnetic shield keeps us that way. Well, then a suitable case to turn Apollo, the sun god, into this woman, quizzical, angry sometimes, and full of flares, as we follow her through the universe, you know, in spirals, the Earth here, and our magnetic shield, which pulls the flare in at the poles, the North Pole and South Pole, the aurora borealis. So it turns the killer into beautiful dance. And that was the symbol which I managed to build, this symbolism in the Sun Amphitheater here, made out of this very primitive rocks and boulders, and with descriptions of it so that people who are interested could follow the science and the mythology. And there you're looking down, made out of rocks that Louisa and I picked up out of the Nith over 25 years. These amazing Lisigang rocks. Here's her eyes, there's her nose, her mouth is down there, there comes her flare, and there it goes into the aurora borealis. So the symbolism is based on contemporary understanding, and it's explained in various ways. And it's popular, so the teachers who teach in the popular school, you know, when we perform it every summer solstice, you're invited, all of you, to come. On June 21st, you don't have to tell people, you know what June 21st is. And so the school children dress up, and their teachers dress up as little green men or, you know, space cadets or whatever. And my paintings and art go on to describe, you know, the Andromeda Galaxy and the Milky Way and what goes on in them. And the rocks, here the rocks themselves were works of art. Here is nature's artist. I mean, we found these incredible 15-foot high specimens of red sandstone. Look at how beautiful they are. I mean, all you have to do is put them up on end and put them 3 feet in the ground and make them permanent. And the center of a galaxy of Andromeda is a black hole, and you can see black hole. I won't go into the science of black holes, but it warps space and time. You know, black holes and gravity tells space-time how to bend, and it bends into a black hole, which sucks everything in. So that's at the top of Andromeda. And it's interesting, when we perform it in these solar festivals around June 24th this next year and June 25th, a performance artist, very good one, Alex Rigg, dresses up his performing troupe in amazing costumes, kind of cross between Japanese, Mongolian space cadets. And then the music is also incredible that is played, these horns, which are prehistoric horns. So he performs it in front of Andromeda, which you can see here, and it's the wonderful stones at the top. And you can see Andromeda and the other Milky Way galaxy there stripping each other, because in 4 billion years, scientists tell us the two galaxies will strip each other. Amazing that we know that now, that will happen. So there's a nighttime painting I did of it, with Andromeda, Milky Way. You walk from there, they're gonna interact and become a super galaxy. And here's a super cluster of galaxies, and you walk on the way, always going north until you reach the multiverse itself. And the multiverse, I mean, if you don't know the idea of the multiverse, it's been a speculation of scientists since a long time. This is a 1640 French view drawing of plurality des mondes. So you see the idea has been around. Of course, people have paid with their life for this theory. And in 1600, the philosopher scientist was put to the stake, Giordano Bruno. But the idea of the plurality of worlds and a multiverse has become more accepted, or at least as a speculation. So it's one that's entertained. And I would say 50 or 60% of cosmologists think it's a good bet, although the evidence is only inferential and spotty, the actual evidence. But the idea is that, you know, we live in a beautiful, well-balanced universe like this vase shape, starting off in inflationary era. And universes that have failed often fail because they run away, the kinetic force is too strong, or they collapse because gravity is too strong. So if you look at this theory and you go through the reasoning, it's called anthropic reasoning, the extraordinary thing is that we happen to inhabit, if this theory is true, the, one of the few multi-universes in which it is not only gravity and the kinetic force, which are balanced to the 50th power, that is 1 over 10 to the 50, with 50 zeros after. In other words, it's a miracle of balance, that close balance. But for 30 other parameters, parameters and constants are also incredibly finely tuned balanced. There's some that are crudely balanced, but of the 30, you know, there are 30 which are pretty fine-tuned. So the argument here for symbolism is that we live in this amazing, miraculous universe where life and other things are possible and have emerged. So I thought, well, the multiverse, which was built out of 100 mudstones, it shows collapsing universes where gravity is too strong, and kinetic universes where that force, and then just right universes, Goldilocks universes coming up the side here and in the center. And again, so the symbolism is partly public. It says, here it says, kinetic force too strong, RIP, RIP. And this one says gravity too strong there, and you can see it collapsing. So if you care, you can follow that, and that's, and the just right universe is well balanced. And in this one, where it's explained, some of the theories explained in detail, if you want to follow it, with the drawings of the collapsed universes and the runaway universes and the well balanced universes over our 13.82 billion years, telling that story there for those who want to sit on the seat and understand it. Well, of course, this is speculation, and we have imagination, and the universe will never be perfect for us. It'll always be a better universe we can imagine, and so naturally we burn the multiverse every year in one way or another, drawing of Madame of Reason, and it's burned above carbon, of course, burning carbon, and you see that's how we do it. We explode it. We have a send-off for the local people, the former coal men and so, and their families. So in a way, it's an ironic and humorous celebration of this theory of the multiverse, and that's why I painted it flying through our universe, because how can a multiverse be inside a universe? You know, it's not logically not possible for you to put the multiverse inside the universe. The universe can be inside a multiverse, but you can't do the other. Anyway, that's the painting. And I end with this shot, which is so poignant, published in the 1880s by Flammarion. We don't know exactly what it symbolizes, which is a nice enigmatic thing. But you can make out a happy sun, you can make out a village, a beneficent village, and you can see a pilgrim here who's fallen, stumbled with his cane, and stumbled through, amazingly, through his worldview into another one, and seeing his heart beats and is waving or drowning as he sees the extraordinary universe we live in and what may be beyond. And of course, because we have imagination, we feel that too. Thank you.
Charles Jencks has time for a few questions. Right now he'll be back up. Thank you so much for those beautiful images and cosmic insights. Before we leave, however, I'll let you know also that he will be in the back signing books in just a few minutes. And also, I wanted to mention three quick things. On November 7th, we have Raymond Jungles as our last speaker in the portfolio series. Next Tuesday, our Landscape Design Student and Alumni Series kicks off with Edmund Hollander. And finally, we have many great classes in our Midtown Education Center just down the street. So pick up a catalog if you don't have one already. And now Mr. Jencks will take some time to answer just a few questions.
Question here, yeah.
Thank you.
I'll repeat it if I can,
sure.
Yeah.
That was a wonderful, wonderful presentation, and I was really struck by how you said that the landscapes can perform what's around them, and I think, and it was so beautiful how it was a reflective rather than an ego-driven design, and I think one of the ways that people around here are trying to do that earnestly is by using native plants and considering ecology design, and it's clear that you're, you know, looking at the earth and material and form, and I'm curious whether or not you do consider ecology or if it's all cosmic and beyond.
Yes. The question is about the relation between the landform or my work and the surrounding and how it does try to perform that, which is absolutely right, and whether ecology itself is a subject which on a cosmic level, and what would be those levels? Well, yes, I think, of course, my work, you know, I'm a landscape designer and landform designer, and it's hard enough, in a way, to try to get the client to accept my symbolism, as I've been suggesting, in an agnostic age. And pay for it, and much less the planting. And I take your point that saying it with plants is a lot more convivial than having to say it with boulders. You know, you say it with flowers, don't you, when you want to express them. But I only have boulders and grass for so much of my work. And but I totally agree with what you're implying here is that, first of all, a big landscape needs intimate smallness, and it needs planting and scent, and it needs all of the things that tie you to the local ecology. And that's what was so moving to Lily and me. When we saw this performance, I didn't explain how amazingly funny it was. I mean, it was a two-hour performance, and it was poignantly funny. Because they had this narrative of their city, which was on all of our mounds, some of it was very straightforwardly mythical, and they had a man dressed up as in white who sang, and he came on a boat, and he was a the shaman. A boatman, a shaman, who was a traditional figure. And he sang, and that was beautiful. And then they had, on another mound of ours, Lily and I could never figure out this, they had a big white piano, and they had Liberace playing while they led a cow up the hill and to sacrifice it, as it were, but they didn't sacrifice. Then all of a sudden, there were explosions, I mean, and real explosions on all of our mounds, and the crane goddesses were dispersed, and pollution came down, and a hard rock band burst into music, and jet skiers came through. And then they started bombing everything. I mean, I'm not kidding. And then there was an explosion on the top of our mounds as these pylons, I thought they were Tory gates, I thought they were, you know, Asian gates, but no, they were pylons. And then factories exploded on another mound. I'm not kidding you, a whole factory blow up, you know, inflatable factory. And then they chased this goddess. There was one crane goddess left and her lover, and they chased her across the water. She ran, and a motorcycle gang came in. And you know, they chased her up the mound, and she got near the top, and then the three young men on motorcycles, you know, hit her, and she fell down. All the time this is being explained in Korean to, you know, 20,000 people. And it was so killing. And so she was lying there. And then two young boys came in from the town, and they put her on the stretcher, and they carried her off. And then, you know, 3 minutes later, out came the whole youth of Suncheon City in Next t-shirts, singing Beethoven's Ode to Brotherhood. I mean, it just drove you crazy. But we couldn't decide whether to laugh or cry. It was so moving, you know. Anyway, they have reinvented themselves, their ecology, through the garden. And I mean, that's incredible, isn't it? So yes, to your answer.